Put it on this camera.
Sorry?
This camera. Not that.
Yeah.
Is it?
Mario's just seeing behind you, I think.
No, all I'm seeing is other people out there.
Yeah. Which people?
Like Ian, someone called Ian.
Oh, so you just need to select just mine.
I see that.
Oh, yeah.
So I don't know how to.
Oh, let's go play with it.
You're a fan.
You could put it in front of the podium, possibly.
Mm.
You just need to speak between those two.
Okay. Can you guys hear me? I know there will be opportunities still, but I haven't. So, I'm going to thank you so much for coming. I'm Esther. I'm one of Malcolm's aunties, and I'm just kind of leading this through this afternoon. On Tuesday, we gathered with Malcolm and Maya, his family and friends in Christchurch. We set up a room similar to what you've got today. We had lots of Malcolm's stuff. His boats were so heavy, I don't know how he lifted his feet, he might have lifted them up. His pack, his ice axe, together with a collection of Mariana's amazing family photos. But today we're back, nestled in this amazing place underneath the mountains. It was a poignant moment for me yesterday as I drove the Fox and passed the familiar Fox Glacier guides that sort of made me aware of the great gap that Malcolm's left. Someone has said over the past few days that Fox was Malcolm and Malcolm was Fox. So for me, this feels like homecoming. It isn't just us and Fox today, but we're joined by Malcolm and Mariana's family and friends who are live streaming from Australia to Brazil and other places around New Zealand and around the world. So, hi everyone, and it's really good to have you with us. And thanks to you guys that are making the technology work for us. When we finish this afternoon, just the Malcolm's immediate family will go up to the Fox Valley from Norwich. Tree next to the stable, and it was covered with vines. And we did something quite silly, but we didn't think at the time. But when you're little, you don't think things are silly sometimes. But we used to swing and jump into the vines way high up in the tree. I don't think we ever thought they might break, but they didn't. We just got a wee sort of land, like a trampoline. And your daddy once found an old chair. I couldn't tell you where he found the old chair. I don't think we were missing one from the house. But he found this old chair and took it up into the tree for a sort of treehouse. Dr. Gordon lived across the road from our house, and Dr. Gordon had a dog, a brown Labrador called Bertie. Well, we didn't have a dog, but Bertie used to come and visit us all the time looking for daddy because he
When Daddy was a bit of a boy, you might not know this about Daddy, he learned to play the trombone. I wouldn't say he practiced very much, but after about 2 years, he put that aside. And we got the trombone in our house, Pedro, so if you ever want to have a turn, ask me next time you're here and we can get it out and we can have a go. Daddy liked to eat rice. I think he still likes rice now, doesn't he? He's a poo right away. And he also liked bread and milk. Does anyone else like bread and milk? I mean, pieces of bread ripped up in a plate, white bread, and you pop hot milk on it. It's a distinct smell, and brown sugar on top. And you liked it very much. I really didn't. I can still smell it, I think. Daddy's favourite place to play was probably the clay ditch. It was behind the church next to our house. We got very dirty. And once when Daddy and I were little, Grandma got upset with us because we had just got into our clean clothes. We were supposed to be going somewhere. I don't know where we were going. But we thought we'd just nip out and just play in the ditch for a wee while. We were just getting ready to go. We got very, very muddy. So Grandma was upset. So Daddy and I thought we'd help. So we stripped off all of our clothes. We didn't accept our gum boots, and we washed our clothes outside in a bucket. It was a very cold, frosty morning. I think I was probably only about 5 at the time, so that's bigger than wasn't it? And then we were about 3. We didn't have Lego, but we had something called Toro, which is a sort of Lego, and Dan was very good at playing with the Toro. He liked building things. And when we got a bit older, he had something called Meccano, which is pieces of metal and nuts and bolts, and we build things with that. It was still playing with Meccano.
I got that for my birthday when I turned 6.
Did you?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. When my kids were your cousins, when they were little, they loved it when your daddy would come with me to pick them up from school. He was the coolest uncle ever. And he had a yellow Hilux, and I used to really like driving it sometimes. I don't know if the yellow Hilux ever made the box, did it? So your daddy had lots of fun when he was little, and he was probably dirty most of the time. And he John Fletcher, you were a lot like your dad, and he seemed to be very good at having fun. And I know that Daddy's going to keep on being proud of you, particularly when you're dirty. So I've got lots of other stories, and I know Uncle Eric has lots of other stories as well. We really enjoy sharing them with you. Your dad was very, very special, and we'll keep on being very, very special.
Because
he's very special, just like you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Maybe white up here.
Hi, everyone. I'm not so prepared because I had my preparation for the service on Tuesday. So I'm just going to say a few random things and leave it to you guys to add what you have to say. For me, as already said, the ultimate Fox and Fox is in mind. I never had a great relationship with Malcolm until we moved here. He would take me all sorts of places, up hills, three rivers, on the beach. All this display is one thing missing, and that's the gauze he dragged me through. But Malcolm's also very special to my two kids, especially Andrew and Sam. He'd come up a few times and did those adventures that I was too boring to do. And also, one very special thing for me was that Malcolm was a celebrant at my son's wedding. And that's kind of cool because I think Andrew thought Malcolm was cooler than me. The other one I should say, because that's been said already, we've heard it from Livestream already. But it was said to say that Pedro, Felipe, Malcolm was proud of you, very proud of you, and also you two ladies. You'll be with us always. We look up the hills, along the beach. Mainly when Felipe's climbing the cupboard walls, then get on the hot shop because that's where the treats are.
Yeah.
Oh, you too. You too. Okay. Okay. All right. Don't want to say that Malcolm, we love you. That's Malcolm I remember. He was this high for 5 years there. The country, this world was his playground. That's right. All I ask you is, remember him. When things are down, remember him. What would Melky do? He would get on with it. Find a way and have a smile. Yeah, that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Delve a little deeper into my list of stories about Malcolm following the last memorial service in Christchurch, but come up with a couple. I first met Mal 17 years ago when he and I worked together as Glacier guys at Fox. However, I first became really close friends with Mal when he heard I'd started hunting, but without a lot of success. He took me under his wing and introduced me to bush stalking. Now, bush stalking takes a lot of patience and concentration. And these are a couple of things that they're really good attributes of Mel's. It turns out they aren't very good attributes of mine. When we were fortunate enough to stumble over a deer, I'd be half asleep. And so it was no surprise that Malcolm shot three deer on his instructional trips. And I came away with nothing. More a case of poor student than bad instruction. But it was through these trips that I really got to know Malcolm and found out just how willing he is to give up his time and to help everyone. A few years later, we became neighbours when Malcolm and Mariana moved into Pekanga Drive. It was one of Malcolm's many ideas to create a shortcut between our houses. Malcolm liked chainsaws, so it's quite appropriate to see one up on display. And his initial idea was just to cut down a section of the fence that divided us. But after a bit of consideration, we decided to instead put ladders on either side. The main downside to the ladder is that you never knew Malcolm's state of dress when he turned up unannounced. But this never fazed him. He's always just completely happy in his own skin. You know, whether it's in front of a group of strangers, with clients, or Stark is in front of the mate. He was always uniquely himself and totally comfortable with this. In recent years, I moved away from Fox, but we remained close. We called each other regularly and always caught up on my monthly trips to Fox. When I was in town, we went on a lot of missions, whether it was hunting, fishing, white baiting, or gold panning. Malcolm always proved to be a good listener on these trips. He'd also always give you his undivided attention. But as good as his listening was, he was a much better talker. He loved to chat and was always good for a yarn or two. And when giving advice, it was always well thought out and balanced. He also had an eclectic knowledge of the most random facts. I can't think of any at this point in time, but he just knew the so many weird, wonderful things. And he had an even wider range of ideas. He was definitely an ideas man, and came up with lots of different ideas that a lot of different people have been place. It's fair to say I got to know Mel pretty well over this time. And I've developed a huge amount of respect for him. Malk had so many great attributes. Positivity, patience, humour, generosity and thoughtfulness are just a few. I'll really miss his friendship, his counsel. But I'm really happy that I knew Malk, and that he will live on through everyone who remembers him. So, yeah. Anyway, great friends, and I'm sure like everyone else, someone will be all really miss.
Me.
Sorry.
Kelsey. That's okay.
I'm calling everybody the wrong. I've just about called Eric Malcolm and Malcolm Eric, which isn't a good mistake to make it.
And he was just, you know, someone that's totally full of life and excited. I've been trying to think of times where he actually, you know, maybe when he was sick once I saw him a bit down, but other than that, he was definitely always the energy in the staff room and just got everyone pretty keen for work. He was also pretty much as West Coast as you can get. Cut off gum boots, slipping in, wearing thongs all the time, which is pretty cool. And seeing lots of people dressed similarly today, which is great. Very Malcolm-esque. Malcolm was an excellent community member, and like Steve said, he was always willing to help. In fact, if you were in the staff room and you just kind of loosely mentioned some plans that you might have, like you might go down to the beach, or for me specifically, once I talked about maybe borrowing the canoe from the guides, and Malcolm's favorite phrase, I think, maybe he didn't know it was his favorite phrase, but he used it a lot, was, you know what you could do?
Yes.
And then you would be like 45 minutes deep in looking at topo maps. And he would start helping you put together this kind of adventure that you didn't really plan. Actually, it was awesome. We went down Jacob's Creek and popped out to the beach and came back up a different creek, totally based off this conversation. So that was pretty amazing. And he would just do that for everyone. He would just show up, and he always knew, he was very creative, knew where to get stuff around town when I was doing the cleanup. Again, he was good at New Zealand topo maps. He could pull it up and he knew everyone's property and who lived where, or where you could get good soil, or who you should chat to about getting sawdust for your house. And he was just pretty special in that way. And like Steve said, he knew a lot about unexpected topics. I think I'm confident I know everything about spider orchids because of Malcolm. He would very excitedly, we'd be driving up the valley doing tours with the guides, and he would stop the bus and tell everyone to get out of the bus, which is not a part of the tour. And we'd all get out, all 20 of us, and he'd huddle us around this spider orchid plant. And spider orchids are actually quite cool, so I'm gonna let you in on it. But they have this like main leaf up the back, and then a little capture device that if it's stimulated with a piece of grass or a bug lands on it, shoots it back and covers it with pollen. So he would get everyone, explain this, and then tickle the little mechanism and it would shoot back, and everyone would laugh or be amazed. And he would giggle and say, "You feel a bit naughty doing that, because you're kind of stimulating the plant." pretty Malcolm basic. And then we would go on a very long terminal, and he just had so many facts. I mean, when he was training you guys, especially at the Valley, it was amazing. Like, he just had so much knowledge of the history, and he's obviously done lots of reading about this place because it wasn't just the time he spent here, but he's obviously done a lot of research. So, yeah, wealth of knowledge and just such a energetic soul that will be a very big hole in your eyes. Really sorry.
Dear Malcolm, you have been a wonderful father to me since the day I moved to New Zealand, and I can't thank you enough. You have shown me so many things that most people don't. Thank you for all your beautiful memories. A special skill I've learned from you and will always be remembered for the rest of my life. No matter what the circumstances, every day was an amazing day. I'm going to miss you, Malcolm. You will be ever the greatest. I love you.
Was my husband, best friends, all of them. He said, I love you every single day, at least once a day, for the last 20 years. It's at least 1,380 calories, but I felt Malcolm's love, not just by the words he said, but all that he did. The way that he looked at me, the way he held my hands, the way he asked me every night, he would go for a walk along the garden and pick up the herbs he bought in the place for me. The way he would call every day after he had dropped off and say, I'm coming home for lunch. I've just gone past Lisa's house in the shortcut. And before I hung up, I already could hear his voice in the driveway. My heart would beat a little bit faster as I saw him moving to the house. He would give me the same hug every day as he walked into the kitchen. Our bodies were like magnets, and my body fit into his chest just like it was molded for it. We never exchanged presents like normal people do. One year for my birthday, Papa probably built me a washing arm. Another year, he gave me to clean up the next. 2 years ago for Christmas, he bought me some coffee.
power tools, like a drill and things. I don't even know what they call. For my last birthday, he gave me a scrap cutter and shaved his beard. He often picked me flowers. Many times there were weeks we found, but we both found them. Our two presents were each other's presents. For a few years, we worked together at the Fox Glacier Garden. Then after that, I worked at Glacier Police Office for 3 years, and he would come to the office every day to talk about the helicopters. That was kind of weird. Before kids, we went hunting, fishing, camping, gold painting, quite creative together. After kids, our lives changed a bit, but we kept doing things together. We made bread together, we made painting together. We built gardens together, greenhouse, cardboard, fences, sheds. We looked after the kids together. We even married people together, him as a celebrant, and me as a photographer. We both would get tummy butterflies every time somebody said, yes, I do. We would smile at each other as a confirmation that marriage is an amazing part of our lives. We homeschooled our kids together. We share the same dreams and lives. We share the same family, and we love each other's company. The only thing we didn't do together was to tidy up. Needless to say, I'll now be returning the million pair of socks back to work. Malcolm was the best husband and father I could have ever asked for. For some reason I can't comprehend, the entire universe conspired for this one tropical Brazilian girl to cross the world and come and live a love story with her ice lover. And for another reason I also can't comprehend, the universe took him away from this physical world and turned him into stardust. May the cracks in my broken heart allow some light to shine through it. Because half of me is gratitude, but the other half is a still despair. May the music I hear in the distance soothe my soul, because half of me accepts it, but the other half is hurt. May the words I speak today not to be taken so seriously, because the half of me is confused, and the other half true. May I have the courage to raise our kids our way, because half of me is my own, but the other half is still Malcolm. But here, so the Malcolm part of me sent me a poem that says, do not weep, do not sting that my grave and weep. I'm not there, do not sting. I'm a thousand winds that blow. I'm the diamond glints on the snow. I'm the sunlight on ripened grain. I'm the gentle autumn rain. When you awaken in the morning's hush, I'm the swift uplifting rush of quiet birds and seagulls flight. I am the soft stars that shine at night. Do not stand in my brain.
Thank you. Serena. I've known Malcolm for being friends with Mariana. He was always so keen to have me coming over for dinner. It's like I can see him just cooking some rice and grabbing some herbs and just in the pot and going like, just rice and herb. It's just like the most beautiful thing to have for dinner. And he'll always love it when I would grab my guitar and play some music. We also work together. When Mariana was saying that they've married people together, they were always so keen to have me coming on board and performing as well at the weddings. So I have a song for Malcolm today, which Mariana has asked me to play because he used to play it a lot, and it also describes very well the way he saw the world, and that's something very inspiring to me, so I hope I can get close to express the appreciation that he felt every time, whenever he was out there.
Thank you. Thank you.
As we do, I can't help but reflect on a tramping trip toward my nephew's top room. A year or two ago up the Copeland Valley to Douglas Rock Hut. Malcolm was working, but he dropped us off and then came back to collect us. He and Lucas walked in to meet us. Malcolm said to me he couldn't possibly walk out not carrying anything while I was carrying my pack. And my pride didn't need any convincing. We are all going to need to share the load around in the coming months, especially for those nearest and dearest. It's far too hard to do this alone. Malcolm, as I have been thinking about you these last few days, I have thought of that ancient Maori saying, a mighty totara has fallen. This life of ours, surely, is a mystery. The beginning is a mystery. And why you have left us so suddenly is total mystery to all of us. The bush, though, that you and Mariana loved, gives us hope. For although the mighty totara has fallen, and Malcolm, we are broken, just like the trees that have come down around you. We know that given time, when we go back and look, we will see new life starting to spring up. And that new life will be nurtured by the trunk of the totara tree. Go in peace, my friend. We will wave at you at the stars. Malcolm, traverse the glaciers. Join the fields swimming in the fast flow of waters. And look after those rock men high in the hoop fields. Our tears will mingle with the rain as it beats down on our face. Because we have loved. Go in peace.
Singing to us as we go.
That is afraid I dropped my papers.
Running like a baby bear.
Yes. Oh, yeah.